Tonight on Wired Science. We'll visit a bank with assets more precious than money.
You guys have decided to donate your bodies. Are you potential donors?
Yes, we are. Our brains and our whole bodies.
It's very hard now. Is that because of the formaldehyde?
That's right. Fresh brain is more the consistency of fresh tofu.
Xia Tong polls the music experts to learn which sounds better, analog or digital.
I'm excited to see if I can tell the difference. I mean, I think I can, but maybe I'm totally wrong.
A well-made LP record is unarguably going to sound better than a compressed MP3 downloaded from some bogus website.
Today, we're challenging private teams from around the world to design and build robotic explorers and race them to the surface of the moon.
We look at the XPRIZE Foundation to find out if big cash prizes really are the best way to spur scientific advances.
We are genetically bred as humans to compete. We compete against other humans. We compete against the environment to get the food we need. We've been evolved to compete.
Lake Mead it's about half full.
What happens if our need for water outstrips our supply?
The reality is the water's gone. The water is oversubscribed. We've given away more water than nature gives to us.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to another thrilling episode of Wired Science. I'm Camila Lopez.
And I'm Chris Hardwick. Say, if you're fast-forwarding your DVR unit until the show actually starts, hopefully you'll be pressing play right about now. These days, major universities, drug companies, and even a few governments maintain their own biobanks, places to store samples of tissue, organs, or even body parts for use in medical research. We made a visit to a biobank in Sun City, Arizona.
This is Sun City, Arizona, an upscale retirement community, average age 75. The town has a lot to offer these seniors, golf, tennis, and a very unusual bank.
But this isn't a normal bank. Here, you can deposit and withdraw commodities that are so valuable they can't be bought or sold. Well, at least, not legally. I'm talking about human body parts.
It's called a biobank. Repositories where human biospecimens are collected, processed, and warehoused. There are hundreds of these facilities around the world, places where donors make deposits and doctors or scientists make withdrawals for use in medical research. Need some human tissue? Maybe some fresh brain? They've got it.
We harvest pieces of all the organs, so heart, lungs, pancreas, kidneys, spleen. Each week we gather up those pieces and ship them out anywhere around the world.
Biospecimens have become an important research tool. Nearly three-quarters of the clinical trials which drug companies submit to the FDA now include provisions for sampling and storing human tissue for future genetic analysis. It's this demand for tissue that spurred the growth in biobanking. The repositories are being built in many settings, from universities to private corporations. But the biobank with the closest relationship to its community is here at the Sun Health Research Institute.
Sun City is the nation's first major planned retirement community, started in 1960. There are about 85,000 retired people living within a 10-mile radius of here. So we have an abundant local population that just loves to participate in research studies.
This is a place where retirees live out their golden years and happily surrender their organs for research.
If you want to study age-related diseases, Harvard in Cambridge, Massachusetts has some of the greatest minds in the world, but all the patients were much smarter. They moved to Arizona a long time ago. And so if you want to study Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease, this is the place to study it.
Finding a cure for age-related diseases like Alzheimer's is high on scientists' hit list. It's estimated that more than 5 million people in the U.S. are living with this progressive brain disorder. By 2050, the disease could affect as many as 16 million Americans. It's SunHealth's access to fresh brains that gives them an edge over other biobanks.
The main thing that sets us apart, really, from all the other brain or biobanks in the world is the rapidity with which we get the brains and organs harvested after death. Our average over 20 years is about 2.7 hours. So under 3 hours, we get the autopsy done, the organs harvested. So I know there's a little bit of atrophy going on. The ventricles are a little bit enlarged, not too bad. I would just call it mild enlargement. You can do scientific work with these brains that you can't do with brains from other sources, especially with the rapid postmortem, the rapid interval between death and harvesting. Nobody else in the world does that.
The brains come from retirees like the Andersons. A former photographer and manager of an Indian trading post, 84-year-old Douglas Anderson now has Alzheimer's disease. His 85-year-old wife, Barbara, is his primary caregiver.
I think I take more pills than he does. I could run a pharmacy, I think. And it's stressful to take care of somebody, to do all the thinking for two people.
So what inspired the two of you to donate your bodies to science?
I guess I've always been the kind of person that wanted to make a difference in the world, and this is one way to make a difference.
We've signed up well over 2,000 people into our tissue bank. Purely word of mouth, no financial inducement, just the goodness of their hearts.
SunHealth keeps close tabs on these valuable living donors.
If we just get the brain after death, that's only half the story. We need to know, how did that brain function during life? How did that brain perform? Was it a high-performing brain, low-performing brain? Was it, in fact, a dysfunctional brain? We need to correlate the function during life with the structure and chemistry we see after death.
Come on back with me, Mr. Hunt.
Today, 89-year-old Ralph Hahn has come in for a checkup. It will become part of his medical history and will someday follow his tissue into the biobank.
Everybody who signs up for it has to go through an annual rigorous assessment every year.
Go.
They get a complete neurological exam. By the time they come to autopsy, we know more about these people than their own doctors.
Their research into Alzheimer's has three long-range goals.
We're going to convert Alzheimer's disease from a terminal disease to a chronic disease. That's the first wave. The second wave will be to genetically identify people, profile them through molecular pathways, PET scans, and the like, and say, you know, your lifetime risk is 10% or 80% you will develop Alzheimer's disease. And then the third wave will be to do prevention, because Alzheimer's changes occur 20, 30 years before your first day of forgetfulness.
The research depends on donors like Ralph and his wife, Estella.
My wife has got a form of dementia, so we agreed to be part of this program over here.
And you guys have decided to donate your bodies. Are you potential donors in their program here?
Yes, we are. Our brains and our whole bodies, both of us.
Now, why on earth would you want to do that?
To help the future problem that the nation faces with Alzheimer's and other forms of dementia.
The bank has harvested more than 1,000 brains.
So this is the healthy part here, and then this is the part affected by Alzheimer's?
That's right. The cerebral cortex here, these squiggly parts are called the gyri. And as you can see, they're separated by gaps. Normally those gaps are not visible, those valley-like gaps. Normally the gyri are pressed more closely together, as you see at the back of the brain here.
It's very hard now. Is that because of the formaldehyde?
That's right. A fresh brain is more the consistency of fresh tofu. But once you treat it with formaldehyde, it gets...
like an eraser.
Yeah.
How many brains do you hold in a day?
Sometimes when we go through for a study, we might hold 50 in a day.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I'll give this back to you now.
Okay.
Next, through the cold storage locker and into the morgue.
Here we've got some brain slices laid out. Now, this is
after the brain has been sliced, after the autopsy.
Uh-huh.
And these brain slices have been fixed, we call it, in formaldehyde.
Mm-hmm.
And this is to preserve them and prepare them for microscopic examination.
During the autopsies, the brains are cut in two. One half for anatomical studies and diagnosis. The other half comes here to be frozen in these ultra-low temperature freezers. Fresh frozen brains can give researchers a look at proteins and DNA for genetic analysis. The temperature is minus 112 degrees Fahrenheit.
The reason we freeze them at such low temperature is to stop the chemical processes. Because as soon as someone dies, the chemistry of decay begins.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to freeze these brains so that they have the chemistry of life, not the chemistry of decay.
These frozen brains have a useful shelf life of about 20 years.
We're a nonprofit organization here, and so we make this tissue as widely available as we can, get the most use out of it, get the most science, the most discovery made as we possibly can. To diagnose the Alzheimer's disease or many other brain diseases, what we have to do is we have to look at a piece of the brain under the microscope. And that's what Colin is doing here right now. He's cutting a piece of the brain with a machine called a microtome. It cuts very thin sections, 1/40th of a millimeter.
Then, the translucent brain slices are flattened, dried, and stained with colors that identify different parts of the cells. The pathologist can then see any injuries or lesions to the cells caused by a disease.
This is how we make the diagnosis of the disease, this rogue's gallery here. These are some pictures of the actual microscopic lesions that we think cause the diseases.
Uh-huh.
So, for instance, this is the Lewy body of Parkinson's disease. These are the neurofibrillary tangles of Alzheimer's disease. These are the senile plaques of Alzheimer's disease, composed of that protein A-beta that I was telling you about.
For a few hours after death, isolated cells are still alive in the body. With quick work, they can be harvested and cultured in the lab. Dr. Li Fen Liu and her colleague, Dr. Douglas Walker, have developed a new procedure to isolate and actually grow cells from the donor brains for use in their experiments.
And these are live.
These are live.
This is moving right here.
The unique properties of the tissue that's given to us allows us to actually develop experimental cellular models, because basically when you're developing therapies, you're going to actually have to do it at the cell basis. So our specialty here is to grow the cells from the blood vessels. This is an example of some blood vessel cells that have been isolated from a 85-year-old elderly person. They've been in culture now for about 12 days.
With these cells, they're studying how diseases or life-saving medicines might enter the brain.
I believe that we will have a way to prevent Alzheimer's disease in the next 6 to 8 years. Not reverse it, but prevent it before that damage is done. I think there's great hope.
I think biobanking is going to continue to be very important. And matter of fact, I think its importance is going to expand incredibly, because with every new development of technology, we just have a much more powerful means of finding the answers.
Answers which may come from the contributions of future biobanking depositors, like Ralph Hahn.
I'm really not giving anything or changing my way of life by donating my brain. If it can help society and people in the future, why just let it burn up?
For Wired Science, I'm Jason Blaylock.
In this corner, weighing in at zero, an MP3, digitized music compressed so you can fit zillions of songs on your iPod. And in this corner, weighing maybe a few pounds too much and wearing khaki pants and a polo shirt, audio engineers convinced that compressed digital sound is murdering the music they love. Tonight, the audiophiles take on the audiophiles.
It's 2007, and breakout band Great Northern is rehearsing their new album. The music will be digitally mastered, electronically enhanced, and ready to download to your iPod with a click of a mouse. But has the ease with which we produce and devour our music led to diminished audio quality? For almost a century, sound was recorded using only analog technology, reproducing sound as close as possible to the original. In the past 20 years, digital technology has almost wiped analog recording off the map, and not everyone is happy about it. Steve Albini is one of the world's top recording engineers, having worked with bands like Nirvana, Joanna Newsom, and the Pixies. Steve Chicago's studio is one of the last that is totally and proudly analog.
A well-made LP record, a good pressing of a good recording on an LP, is unarguably going to sound better than a compressed MP3 downloaded from some bogus website.
Ken Andrews is another world-class engineer. He's worked with Beck, Tenacious D, and Black Rebel Motorcycle Club. For Ken, there's a reason digital recording has become the industry standard.
To my ear, it's more accurate right off the floor.
Sound is vibrating changes in air pressure, which travel in a continuous wave and cause similar vibrations in our eardrums. Analog recording mechanically duplicates those continuous vibrations using the grooves of a record or the flux of a magnetic tape passing through a tape recorder.
Almost every home music lover is in search of the same thing, the truest, most lifelike reproduction of the original music possible.
In digital recording, computer chips slice up those continuous sound waves into separate bits of information called samples. The faster the sampling, the more the recorded sound resembles the original. But to the audiophile, the sampling is nothing more than a cheap imitation of the original sound. So why do you think there's been this huge debate in the music world?
In the beginnings of the digital audio recording technology, digital recording didn't sound particularly good. It was sort of rushed into existence as a cutting-edge technology, but before it was really wrung out on a technical level. The early digital formats weren't very reliable. CDs, for example, didn't generally sound as good as good vinyl records. Digital audio recording had limitations in frequency response.
For Ken Andrews, modern digital recording has long overcome those early weaknesses. What would you say that digital can do that analog can't?
That's a long list. Editing, I think, is the number one thing. Most digital recording is straight to the computer. And you can do a lot of that kind of editing on tape, but it's way more tedious, and it's actually a lot more dangerous, too, because if you make the wrong cut, you can actually end up ruining your master. Whereas with digital, everything is non-destructive. Every edit you make can be undone. All of your original performances are kept. You can record a whole song and decide, you know what would happen if we put the bridge before the second chorus instead of after the second chorus? You can hear that right away.
But Steve Albini claims he can achieve the same result with a razor blade.
Yeah, editing in the analog domain is exactly the same as editing in the digital domain. You're taking different sections that you want to keep and sticking them together.
But you're working with something physical here.
But here you're physically sticking them together with physically sticky tape.
Ken points out that analog recordings have durability issues.
One of the things that is a problem with analog was as you continue to play back that tape and add overdubs, every time that tape hits the playhead, you're losing a little bit of the oxide that is on the tape. You're continually degrading the tape, and there's been some pretty serious horror stories about people when they finally are finished with their mix, they look at the tape that they're playing back for, and then they can see through it.
But Steve is worried that fast-changing digital technology may not hold up to the test of time.
Digital data is much, much more fragile than analog recordings are. I mean, magnetic recordings have been around for close to a century, and they still, you know, they're all still playable. You can find virtually any magnetic recording ever made and string it up on a machine and play it one way or another.
But for us listeners, do analog and digital really sound that different? To find out, we joined Great Northern at Firehouse Studios. The band has recorded on both analog tape and digital computer.
When we first started recording on tape, it definitely sounds richer and deeper and more gritty, and there's little blips that you can hear in the tape that you never hear when it's clean on the computer. But on the computer, it's a lot easier because you can do a million takes, and you know, you don't have to splice and go back to the tape, and like, it's not this whole ordeal where you better get it right the first time.
To settle the analog versus digital debate, DigiDesign, the makers of the recording software Pro Tools, helped us devise a simple test. We brought in two unbiased recording engineers known for their golden ears.
Okay. When we put our heads together,
we make one big ear.
There you go. These are the best ears of our lives.
These gentlemen have worked with some heavy hitters.
Justin, Beyonce,
Duran Duran,
Michael Jackson. So I think we can hear gnats from 10,000 miles away, but truthfully, it's just to see, you know, if we can hear and depict tones and different tonalities.
In one corner, we have our recording engineers. And in the other corner, Great Northern.
I'm excited to see if I can tell the difference. I mean, I think I can, but maybe I'm totally wrong.
Yeah, I don't know.
One song will be played. Some verses were created using an analog console, and others are digital. They're randomly arranged within the song. The question, who's got the real golden ears? Who can recognize the difference between analog and digital? If you want to cheat, the correct answer is at the bottom of the screen. After 20 verses, the test is finished.
Awesome. We were exactly the opposite the whole time.
I felt like I was guessing.
Do I get a cookie?
No cookies will be awarded. In fact, no real decisive winners emerged. Final score? The Golden Ears got it right 55% of the time. Great Northern, 53%. So maybe there is no great difference in the sound quality between analog and digital. Even though digital recording has become the norm, software is now able to imitate the warm and fat tones of analog in the console.
What, you know, everyone I know is talking about right now is that the differences are almost indistinguishable because of the software that's coming out that emulates analog consoles specifically. You can basically create a mix completely inside the computer that sounds like it was done on an analog console.
While digital may be emulating the analog sound, analog recordings eventually end up in the digital domain. So what's the point of keeping analog alive?
What you're recording ends up on CD ultimately doesn't end up being digital anyway?
Yeah, but by the same token, if you make a fantastic motion picture, you know, if you make an incredible film and someone ends up watching it on his iPod, that doesn't mean that there's no point in making the film high quality to start with.
So what does the future hold?
Do you think people are going to mourn the loss of the CD to the MP3 just like they mourn the loss of, you know, the record to the CD?
I think that some are mourning it now already, but I don't know. I'm in a subset of people who are kind of maybe ahead of the curve, so we've already left CDs behind a while ago. I think the idea of getting music in a file format is definitely on the rise and is probably going to completely take over here really quick.
For Wired Science, I'm Zaya Tong. Bree Pettis hacks cool things from stuff we might have lying around the house. His blog and his Make Magazine podcast, Weekend Projects, have made him famous in the world of online DIY. Tonight, Bree will show us how to turn a disposable camera and a few electronics parts into a high-speed stroboscopic photo rig, which can freeze actions lasting less than a hundredth of a second. Welcome, Bree.
Hi, Zaya.
Very good to have you here.
It's a pleasure to be here.
So now, why do we need a strobe to capture high-speed images?
Well, there are some events that we want to capture that are just happen in a fraction of a second, and it can be really hard to get those otherwise. So let me show you. Here, go ahead and take a picture of me.
Okay.
As I pop a balloon.
Okay.
And we're going to try and get the exact moment where it's mid-pop.
Okay. Okay, so count me down.
3, 2, 1.
Okay. Let's see if that, oh, it's empty.
There I am. The balloon has popped, and you can even see it down there in the corner.
Not a bad photo.
Yeah, but we really wanted to get it just as it was half popping, and that's really hard.
So what do we got here?
Well, we're going to use a one-time use camera to be a triggerable flash. And by that, what we're doing is we're doing a hack. And a hack is when you take something that normally does one thing, and you get into it and you make it do something else. So
okay.
We're going to go ahead and make this from a disposable camera into a triggerable flash.
What's the microphone for?
The microphone is going to listen for the balloon popping. When it hears that pop, it makes the flash go off.
Okay.
The first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna take this sticky paper off. I've already done this and I've got one right here. The next thing to do is we're gonna take this apart. Now this is a little tricky. These are made to come apart. Usually they recycle these at the camera place.
Okay.
You want to be careful not to touch the electronics in here because there is a capacitor in here. There we go. Okay, so what we've got here is, here's the insides. This is the capacitor. And if electricity going through wires is like water going through a hose, a capacitor is a bucket. It lets electricity build up in there until it's full, and then you can dump it out. In this case, the electricity gets dumped out into the flash, and it makes all that energy gets turned into light.
Is this going to be dangerous then, or?
It could be dangerous if we don't discharge that capacitor. So hold that, don't touch the metal, because this is insulated. And go ahead and see those two little pieces of metal?
These two?
Yep, go ahead and touch them.
So just by touching them, I'm going to discharge the capacitor?
Exactly.
Nice, and that's it?
You got it.
Okay.
Yep, you see the little spark?
Yeah.
That's the electricity coming out.
Thank you.
This is safe. Go ahead and touch it again, just because sometimes there's
just
a little
risk. Just to be safe, okay.
Yeah, it's always good to just double check. Okay, you're golden.
Okay.
Perfect. Okay, now we can really get into this without worrying. We're going to rip off the lens and the shutter assembly. We don't need those anymore.
So we're not using this as a camera?
Nope.
Seems an odd way to take photos by taking apart another camera, you know?
We're actually just going to be using the capacitor and the flash and the way that those two relate to each other.
Gotcha.
Now we're going to take the back off. I'm going to take this mini jack that I've already soldered up here.
Okay.
And I'm just going to put this right through here.
And is the mini jack for the microphone?
No, the mini jack plugs into the flash controller, which then plugs into the microphone. And so now we've got this coming on this side. That just makes it neater. I'll solder up this side. I'm just going to hold the trigger and let these melt and then put them together. And then I'm going to let you solder this side. There you go.
Okay. So just press the little gun?
Yep. And you can let it go and it should stay. And you don't want to breathe these fumes. There we go.
Just like that and then let it dry?
Yeah, it cools down and then it's solid.
Okay.
Now we just need to put it back together and we're good to go.
So are these like Christmas presents that you make for your friends? Here's a high-speed camera. I just made this for you.
You know, I gave one of these to my grandpa who's really into photography.
Yeah?
He really loved it. Okay. We've got the battery all hooked up and we're just gonna smush it all back together.
Okay.
And the top goes on there. And you're basically just gonna kind of smash it all down. Hopefully it'll go back together somehow.
Just like this.
Yep.
Right.
So now we've got the jack there and we can test it. Let's go ahead and test it. Let's take this bundle of wire and one side will go in here. And you can go ahead and plug that right into there.
Okay.
So this is the flash controller kit and you can go ahead and get this online for under $100 or you can even find the instructions on how to make it and solder it together yourself.
Great.
You can set how sensitive the microphone's gonna be and how long after the sound effect happens till it makes the flash happen. So let's charge it up.
Okay.
And I'm just gonna snap. Oh, it heard me talking and it went off.
It's that sensitive.
Yeah, so.
Nice.
It works.
Great, okay. It's all connected.
Let's take some pictures.
Ready.
Now with your camera, I'm gonna go ahead and set this on bulb setting. That means when I push the button down, the shutter opens and it stays open until I take my finger off. Now it's best to do this in really dark light and that'll make for a really long exposure which will give you time to make the event happen while the shutter's open.
Okay.
Okay, so what you're gonna do is we're gonna dim the lights so that it's as dark as we can get it. We're gonna count down and I'm gonna have you say 3, 2, 1 and then you're gonna push it down.
Okay, so I'm ready for you. 3, 2, 1, cheese. See if that worked. Oh, that's beautiful. There's the shadow of its former balloon self.
Oh yeah, it caught it right at the end as it was going.
That's quite pretty.
Next, we're gonna get a little destructive. What we're gonna do is we're gonna take a CD, and when CDs break, they break very dramatically. They crack and they explode, basically. So we're gonna go ahead and put this on here, and I'm gonna have you hit it with a hammer.
Okay, let's now, make sure this isn't a CD I wanna destroy first.
Now, CDs, these little particles are gonna fly everywhere, so you wanna put on some safety goggles here, some safety glasses. We always want to protect our eyes. And let me
go ahead. I'm always destroying things on the show.
Are you?
Seems that way. Okay.
Okay, watch your eyes. And 3, 2, 1.
Did that work?
Let's see. Yeah, it did.
Beautiful. And that one's very artistic.
Very explosive.
I quite like these. Thank you so much, Bree, for being here with us.
My pleasure. Anytime you want to do some hardware hacking.
Good stuff. So for complete instructions on the high-speed photo project, check out the Wired Science website at pbs.org.
When a rocket designed by ace engineer Burt Rutan became the first privately built craft to take a person to the edge of space, the world changed a little. His Spaceship One was built to win a $10 million X Prize. Now that model, Prizes for Innovation, has been taken up by NASA, the Pentagon, and even private industry. We went to see whether many of the world's problems can really be solved by offering prizes.
Since the dawn of the space age, only two nations have actually gone to the moon. And no one's been there in over 30 years.
At the annual Wired Next Fest, held this year in Los Angeles, aerospace entrepreneur Peter Diamandis made a big announcement. We're going back to the moon. And we're going back courtesy of two of the biggest geeks out there.
You may have thought the Google Moon product that we introduced a few years ago was just for fun, but now you know we're serious about it.
We're optimistic that we will have a lunar landing by the time this prize is done.
The Google Lunar X Prize is the latest in a series of X Prizes all designed to jumpstart technological breakthroughs through big-ticket competitions.
Today, we're challenging private teams from around the world to design and build robotic explorers and race them to the surface of the moon. The grand prize is $20 million awarded to the first team to soft land on the moon, rove for at least 500 meters, send back two sets of high-definition video and photographs.
So, you want to try and win the $20 million Google Lunar X Prize. Here's some of what you'll need to do. Find a commercial rocket company that can launch your vehicle. Outfit your landing module with retro rockets so it doesn't crash land. Build a digital camera that can withstand 540-degree shifts in temperature. And if $20 million isn't enough incentive, there are bonus prizes worth at least $5 million more for assembling a team with ethnic and gender diversity, and for photographing the remains of the Apollo landings. Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines.
We are genetically bred as humans to compete. We compete against other humans. We compete, you know, against the environment to get the food we need. We've been evolved to compete.
I'd like to begin with a quote from Charles Lindbergh.
In 1996, when Peter Diamandis created the X Prize, space research was dominated by big government. He announced a contest, a challenge, to design, build, and fly the first private spaceship capable of carrying three people into suborbital flight and back to Earth twice in 2 weeks.
In 1996, it was inconceivable that a private entity could build a ship that would reach a suborbital altitude.
But 26 teams from around the world joined the race. There was a cosmonautics club in Romania, a spacesuit designer in Argentina, a computer game programmer in Texas, all spending hundreds of thousands of dollars of their own money and what they could raise from investors. Among the competitors was Burt Rutan. He was already famous for designing the Voyager aircraft, the first plane to circle the globe without refueling. The X Prize gave him the inspiration to design his first ever spacecraft, which he called Spaceship One. Twice in October 2004, Spaceship One, burning a specially formulated rocket fuel, climbed 62 miles to the edge of space and back, winning the first X Prize. The idea of using contests to fuel innovation isn't new. In the 1920s, the Ortigue Prize challenged the world's best aviators to be the first to fly nonstop between New York and Paris. Charles Lindbergh won the prize in 1927 when he crossed the Atlantic in the Spirit of St. Louis.
You know, he didn't fly for his health, he flew to win a prize. This inspired Peter Diamandis. He said, if prizes caused the aviation industry to move forward so rapidly, why couldn't the same sort of incentive be applied to aerospace?
Charles Lindbergh won $25,000. Burt Rutan won $10 million, and he spent many times that amount to get there. It helped that Rutan's business partner was one of the richest men in the world, Microsoft co-founder Paul Allen. Besides the prize money, Rutan and Allen got a head start on what may become a lucrative new business, private space travel.
You know, there is this notion of the rich get richer. And even to be able to play the game, it seems that if you're getting the money after the fact, then you already have to have the funds or the resources or the friends to call up to help you get the funds. So that's clearly not helping sort of the everyman child inventor who might otherwise be lost to the annals of history.
The success of the suborbital flight award made XPRIZE a brand name. Peter Diamandis recruited a staff of advisors to suggest other multi-million-dollar XPRIZE competitions.
We are working on a global entrepreneurship XPRIZE to address poverty. We're working on education XPRIZE. We're working on XPRIZES in clean water or the production, storage, and transmission of energy. So we are working on the things that fundamentally affect us here today, as well as looking at things over the next 10 to 20 to 30 years.
The second $10 million XPRIZE contest was announced in 2006. This one was for genetics, not space travel. The goal is to accelerate the pace of human genome sequencing, something that could have profound benefits for medicine.
The current technology, the best anybody says they are able to do, is to sequence a whole human genome with great degree of accuracy, taking many, many months to do, and still costing in excess of $1 million. We're asking that this prize be something that can be done in a matter of a day or two and at a cost of less than $10,000.
XPRIZE expects the genomics contest to continue through 2010. Meanwhile, other groups besides XPRIZE are jumping on the competition bandwagon. There are big money contests to reduce greenhouse gases, to enable internet connectivity in the third world. Even NASA adopted the XPRIZE model to find a better astronaut glove. Back at Wired Next Fest, the man who started it all, Peter Diamandis, is starting the countdown for the next rocket to the moon.
4, 3, 2, 1, let the race begin.
The fact that lots of other organizations, NASA and DARPA, just to name two, are adopting the competition model is a real victory for our guest today. Peter Diamandis trained as a medical doctor, but now he has his hands in a bunch of space-related businesses, and he founded the XPRIZE Foundation. He's here to talk with Adam.
Peter Diamandis, thanks for coming in. I appreciate it.
My pleasure.
So, where did the interest in space come from?
Ever since I was 9 years old, I wanted to be an astronaut, and I figured NASA would be the way to go do it. And then somewhere along the lines, I decided that it probably wasn't the best way, and I wanted to do it privately.
What made you think joining up with the program wasn't a way to get to space?
Well, I figured the odds, okay? Your chances are 1 in 1,000 of becoming an astronaut. And then
just when you apply, or if you send in, I'd like to sign up?
When they do an astronaut call, and they do that every number of years, they'll select a class of 10 or 20. There's only been under 500 astronauts ever that have flown into space.
Right.
It's the most exclusive planet, you know, club on this planet. And then half of the astronaut corps in the US have never flown. Now, they call them penguins because they have wings, but they don't fly. And I said, there's got to be a better way to do this. And then plus the idea of having to go work for the government and being told what to do, what you can't say, that's not for me. And so I said, what can we do to try and create a commercial space program, one that's sort of married to the tourism industry and the entertainment industry, and allows me to go and others to go when I want to. Just like, you know, if you're a scuba diver, you don't have to go join the Navy. You can put on your scuba gear and go and explore.
But let me flip that around. The answer is going to space is really hard. Fundamentally, that's the answer, right?
It is hard. It is hard today. It's getting easier. But just like anything we start in the beginning is hard. You know, building computers was something the government only did in the 40s and 50s, and now, you know, you get them free in your cereal box.
That would be cool, actually.
I think it will happen. But we are getting to the point that it will be cheaper and cheaper. If you do the energy calculations of what it costs you and me to actually go into space, you can do the calculations of how much potential energy and kinetic energy. And if you were to buy that energy off the electric grid, you know how much it would cost you? $100. So today on the space shuttle, 6 people go up, it costs $600 million. It's $100 million a person to go into space. That's what it costs NASA.
They're paying for more than kinetic energy, to be fair.
They are. Listen, NASA is an amazing organization doing a lot of great things, but it's not their mission to make it cheaper.
Okay.
Or to make it possible for the public. They're about exploring. The job of getting the public into space is commercial industry. And that's what, you know, commercial industry does two things. It makes it cheaper, it makes it better. And that's what capitalism is about. And so I've been trying to engage that capitalistic engine outside of the industrial military complex to get me into space and my friends and others who want to go.
Talk about what some of the next X Prizes are going to be. What else are you working on?
Well, we've launched already the Archon X Prize for genomics, sequencing 100 human genomes in 10 days.
Wow.
We're launching the Automotive X Prize, a new generation of cars that exceed 100 miles per gallon equivalent, are affordable, look great, low carbon emissions. We're working on a Cancer X Prize. We're working on an X Prize in education, in global entrepreneurship. Really, wherever there's a grand challenge, we want to create an X Prize that motivates brilliant, radical thinkers to go and solve it.
Once you've kind of laid out the broad fields that you want to get into, how do you choose an objective for the prize? How do you pick exactly what to get people to try for?
Well, it turns out our board of trustees, and we have something called the Vision Circle, which are folks who are our biggest benefactors. They contribute $2.5 million. Larry Page was the first, and they work with us, and we say, where should we be focusing our energy on? What prize areas? And together with staff and our board and the Vision Circles, we sort of said, this is an area we want to go and create a prize. We'll write the rules, go out and find the corporate sponsor, the philanthropist, and then launch it in a really big way.
But are you trying to find kind of a game-changing question in that field?
Yeah. It's got to be something where it's stuck. The industry is stuck. It's not moving fast enough. There's political forces, or people just don't believe it can be done. And we try and set a set of rules that's intersection of achievable and audacity.
I'm interested in how the prize model connects to that capitalist instinct that you were talking about, and also fosters innovation, which I understand is the point, right?
So I read this book called The Spirit of St. Louis. Lindbergh, as it turned out, crossed the Atlantic in 1927 to win a $25,000 prize, and I had no idea.
Okay.
This Frenchman, Raymond Ortega, offers out this prize from New York to Paris, and I'm making markings in the book, and I'm reading and saying, wow, 9 different teams spend $400,000 to win this $25,000 prize. That's incredible. Yeah, that's efficiency.
Figuring that because that return on investment is kind of non-existent, they weren't in it for the money.
The prize galvanized this huge amount of global interest. And Ortega, who was putting up the prize money, never paid any of the losers. He paid only the winner. And I said, what an incredibly efficient way to cause a breakthrough. And so by the time I had finished reading The Spirit of St. Louis, this idea for an X Prize, what was a $10 million cash prize for the first private team to fly 3 people up into space, come back down, and within 2 weeks make the trip again, had come to my mind. It just took me forever to raise the money to get it out there.
Now, how does the idea of prizes as a way to foster innovation fit into the context of other funding of science and innovation? I'm thinking, you know, since World War II, we've had the kind of Vannevar Bush model of governments accrue a lot of money through taxes, mm-hmm. and then they give a lot of money to big projects and small things like the National Science Foundational Fund. And then there's the idea that, sort of rich people will, at the tail end of their career, start giving money that they made back, Carnegie or Bill Gates. Where do prizes fit into either of those structures?
Great question. So, typically, you have government grants or research grants. When you create a competition, which got television and media, you allow for corporate sponsors now to come in and fund scientists. You allow for wealthy philanthropists to come in and fund scientists. And typically, these incentive prizes get 10 to 40 times the amount of the prize money being spent to win the prize.
Last thing, why is it called an X Prize?
God almighty. You know, when I named it the X Prize initially, X was a variable to be replaced by the name of the person who gave me the money. It just took so darn long to raise the money, you know, that the X stuck around.
So now it's just extreme.
Extreme, exceptional, Roman numeral 10 for 10 million. Hey, it worked really well.
Peter, thanks a lot.
My pleasure. Thanks.
You might be familiar with the phrase peak oil. That's the idea that oil, a finite resource, is running out. But here's another impending crisis, one that all the Prius drivers in the world can't stop. Peak water. Water's a disappearing commodity too, but nowhere more than in the American Southwest. Every continent has a desert. They're a fifth of the surface of the world. Too arid to sustain anything but the sparsest of life. But people live in them. This is North America's desert, in the Southwest, the location of two of the fastest growing cities in the United States, Phoenix, Arizona, and Las Vegas, Nevada. To survive, they pull most of their water from the Colorado River. But what if the water ran out? Fresh water is, after all, just another natural resource. What if cities like these, all over the planet, are drinking it all? We are, some scientists think, making a desert planet. We may be reaching peak water. Between Phoenix and Las Vegas, just off Route 66, is the little town of Kingman. And if you want to know what a peak water world looks like, you could ask Earl Kemp. He's 78 years old, and he lives 16 miles outside Kingman, off the grid. Every 2 days, Kemp goes to fetch water from the closest well, 4 miles away.
I have a water trailer that holds 250 gallons a trip. Then I transfer it from the water trailer into my holding tanks. The holding tanks supply the house.
Try to catch every drop. You can't imagine what it's worth.
Every drop is sacred.
You probably don't share that healthy reverence for water, especially if you were born anytime after the 1930s. That was the heyday of the United States construction of massive waterworks, like the Hoover Dam on the Colorado. Behind it, Lake Mead, the largest artificial lake in the country. It assures supply to Arizona, California, Nevada, and northern Mexico. And a decade of drought have definitely left their mark.
It's about half full. So when you go as a visitor to Lake Mead, one of the first things you see is what is often termed a bathtub ring. And it's just truly from calcification from the water when the water was last that high in the late 90s.
But droughts and peak water are two entirely different things. There have always been droughts, but there haven't always been so many thirsty humans. That bathtub ring is bad news for Vegas. Over 160 people move there every day, but the city can't sustain that pace if it can't get more water, especially the way it treats that resource. The undeveloped space around Phoenix has some of the same problems.
In rural Arizona, the non-metropolitan areas, the developers go to the Department of Water Resources and try to get a determination of, as to whether or not they have 100 years of water. If they do not, they are still allowed to build their houses and the industries are still allowed to move into that area. The difference is they put on their real estate documents that the Department of Water Resources has found that they do not have an adequate water supply. So there is some disclosure to those customers, but they can continue to grow without that certainty have an adequate water supply.
It's not clear to me why people love to move to hot, dry places, but we do. So how are we going to meet the demands of future populations? For one, we have to rethink growth. We have to no longer assume that people can move to a region and somehow we're going to find the water for them. Water is a finite resource. It's limited in the Southwest. It's very expensive to move very long distances. We're going to have to become more efficient in what we do with our water.
Phoenix is looking peak water straight in the eye, and the city has a plan. A 50-year plan that involves reclamation, conservation, and storage. Lots of storage.
In Phoenix, we have about 1,500,000 people living here. And we look at our conservation program as a partnership with our citizens. And we have seen quite a bit of reduction in water supplies over the years. In the 1980s, the per capita use on a daily basis in Phoenix was 267 gallons per day. We are now at about 198 gallons per day.
Phoenix enforces strict plumbing codes, water restrictions on large turf facilities, and provides low-flow toilets to low-income housing.
In the last 3 to 5 years, our population has increased by 300,000 people, but our total water deliveries is the same. So those are both indications that our conservation programs are very effective. But in terms of the water supply for the city of Phoenix, we really are in very good shape.
That's not to say there won't be limits. Only 10% of Phoenix's water is groundwater or reclaimed water, but a third comes from the Colorado, and more than half comes from Arizona streams.
We have a large cushion between our current water demand and our water supplies.
In order to store what precious water they do have, the city has taken an innovative approach. It's called a water bank, and it'll help keep Phoenix hydrated through long periods of drought. It's one of the largest water banks in the United States. Most of the water comes from the Colorado River. It's pumped through a canal, into a delivery channel, and then fed into basins lined with sand and gravel.
The Phoenix area is blessed with big, deep alluvial aquifers, and it's soil that has eroded away from the mountains and filled up a basin
over thousands and thousands of years, so it's really a big reservoir under the ground.
The water seeps through the gravel into a natural aquifer far below. Eventually, the massive aquifer fills up, a vast underground artificial lake. This is the Granite Reef Underground Storage Project, GRUSP. It's actually a series of several interconnected vaults, and it can store 200,000 acre-feet of water per year. How much is that? Well, in a year, a family of four uses about 1 acre-foot. The flow of water into and out of GRUSP is as complicated as flights leaving and arriving at an international airport. And like an airport, GRUSP has traffic controllers.
One water master will take the north side, one water master will take the south side, and they will combine all the orders and determine what we need from reservoir or what we need to cut back into reservoir so that by the time the water gets to the end of the system, we have just enough to cover what we need for our users. I have four sets of three gates to operate. Will show me the size of the gates, the position of the gates, and if we were to make a change, click the mouse button, and the gate will instantaneously go up.
With these computers, they keep their hands firmly on the spigots, regulating water as it gets pumped out of the aquifer and into a series of dams, lakes, canals, laterals, ditches, pipes, and valves, and eventually to the faucets of Phoenix. GRUSP and measures like it have put Arizona in a much better position, water-wise, than their thirsty neighbors in Nevada. So the state's horse trade. Nevada has 530,000 acre-feet banked in GRUSP, and they're planning to double that. So Phoenix, a city on the near side of peak water, doing everything it can to stave off collapse. And that's laudable. But Phoenix is the exception, not the rule. Pessimistic strategists think that the wars of the future will be fought not over land or oil, but over water. And to understand why, all you have to do is think of Earl Kemp and imagine a planet full of people, 6 billion of us, living just like him. And every 2 days, we all drive to the same well.
Okay, that's the show. Thanks for watching.
Yeah, but I think the message here is clear. The world is doomed, and the sooner Peter Diamandis builds a rocket so we can all leave, the better.
Say goodnight, Chris.
You mean you wouldn't leave if you had the chance?
Oh yeah, I'm leaving. Good night.
All right, I guess I'll follow.
Check out our website to learn more about the ethics of biobanking.
We've signed up well over 2,000 people into our tissue bank.
And how we're stretching our strained water resources. It's all at wiredscience@pbs.org.
Science is made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.